Yeah, hello everyone. I welcome you all to the live session with Dr. Ronak Jain. And in this video, I'm going to talk about the general topics about the medical courses and problems doctor facing on daily basis. So kindly stay tuned. Dr. Ronak will be joining us in a couple of minutes. Yeah, hello.
Hi Shiva.
Hello, Dr. Ronak. Welcome to my channel.
Hello. Hello Shiva. Thank you so much for inviting the invitation.
Thank you. Are you able to hear me clearly?
Yeah, I'm able to hear you clearly.
Yeah, this session is just a general one, not a very technical.
I found it very useful too. Thank you, Rohit.
Yeah. So let's go with this introduction session about you introducing yourself to the audience and the viewers from your school and education.
I'm Dr. Ronak Jain. I'm working as a final year postgraduate in Stanley Medical Hospital. I'm doing my training in internal medicine, MD, which is also a kind of specialist for COVID infection. And I did my schooling in St. Mary's, Armenian Street, Chennai.
Okay, thank you. Could you just rotate the screen to the portrait mode? I think I'm seeing you a little upside down. Now it's fine. Yeah, this view is fine. Yeah.
Okay.
So let's go with the starting one, which. When did you first get the idea, like the seed, like when did you want to like pursue a course in medical field, and what was the basic seed, when did you get in your mind?
I had a passion of becoming a doctor during my childhood itself, like when I was in 6th, 7th standard. I liked the patient's reaction after they get treated and how they thank the doctors and how much they are filled with gratitude. So that made a difference actually, and I really wanted that on my patient's face in the future if I become one. So I really wanted to become a doctor.
Okay, cool then. Like normally, what are the options like in the non-medical field other than doctor? Like becoming a doctor, what are the other options in the like what to say? Let me put a different thing. What are the options for becoming a doctor after this biology group in plus two? Like after a course,
you take biology, you can go to into various other fields like research. You can go into biotech, nanotech,
Okay.
all the research fields you can go, genetics, so dentistry. These are some of the other fields which relates to biology.
Okay.
As in vaccine production, vaccine research, scientist, becoming a scientist.
So
So
these
these
are
are
all the
some.
other options. Okay. So is the NEET exam necessary for the current school passouts to enter into medical field?
Yeah, as of now, NEET UG is mandatory, but we'll have to see whether after this COVID, whether the exams are going to be kept or not. We'll have to see. And but as of now, yeah, NEET UG is mandatory.
So, like, is it does it vary from like in states or the to for in the total India? Is it applicable to the all the states in India?
NEET UG has a quota for all over India, so all states
Okay.
have to give a limited number of seats to the All India quota. And some states have their own specific reservations, which varies from state to state. There's a state
Okay.
quota and an All India quota. So through All India quota, we get the NEET UG is all helpful, and also it's also helpful for the states, and they can provide additional marks and has an incentives to fill up
Okay.
their state quota seats.
So, like, in which year was this introduced? I guess when 5 6 years back, or like it's been from many years, this NEET
Yeah,
exam entrance.
when I entered my UG, first year of
Okay.
MBBS, it was based on 12 standard marks. There was nothing like NEET UG or a single exam. It was state-wise exams. Each state had their own selection exam for MBBS. So it came after maybe like into 2012 or 2013, somewhere around that.
So a year after you passed out from school, the NEET was
2 years
introduced.
after I joined my MBBS, 2 to 3 years after.
Okay then. Like the other important question now is this: foreign medical graduates, FMGs, those who did their MBBS in Russia, Philippines, etc. Why are students opting to study abroad to become a doctor, especially from India?
The thing is, we have much of a caste and reservation-based system. Becoming a doctor should be purely based on merit, and even if it's like there is reservation in UG, I totally agree with that. But having reservations in postgraduate exams, because everyone is one after passing your UG,
Okay.
everyone has studied the same subjects and everyone has got the same chances. So as of now, I'm talking about NEET PG exams and not NEET UG. Reservations in NEET UG is it's their own political agenda. But regarding having reservations in NEET postgraduate exams, that is after completing your MBBS, you still have reservations for any group for that matter. Maybe it be caste based or maybe it be economy based. Any such criteria should not be there, because everyone is studying the same subjects, everyone is studying for 5.5 years, everyone has worked in the similar hospitals, and everyone has got equal opportunities during the 5.5 years as MBBS doctors.
Okay.
So people are going out after completing the MBBS. They are going to UK, they're going to US, they're going to all sorts of countries after completing the MBBS, because they're not acknowledged for their knowledge. But it's the caste-based or the economy-based reservation that is preventing them from getting the desired seat.
Okay. So, like, the infrastructure and the facilities, like in the lab facilities, what do you think? Like, is it much superior than India, or on what basis are they opting for to study there, other than this, this politics and caste systems? What are the other reasons why people like
Mainly
go
for the
abroad to
peace
study?
of mind. As I said, the Indian mentality is that they come to the doctor at the last moment and they expect the doctor to magically just give some medicines and the patient should be cured without any complications. The problem is that the Indian people, that they expect that we doctors can treat everything. We are gods. And, we try our best to treat our patients, We never want to harm our patients. We try our best and we feel happy when our patient recovers. But some attenders and some Indian patients or Indian family attenders, they are like, whatever the complication arises out of the medicines or out of any procedure for that matter, it is a usual complication that they should understand will occur in any procedure. Nobody is going to give you 100% guarantee that you'll be all right after that treatment.
So it's basically the mindset which is leading
Yeah,
these people to
they
go.
just come at the last moment. They go to all quacks, they go to all other forms of medicine. I'm not telling that it's wrong, but they should keep that in mind that it has their own set of it delays the treatment they should get earlier, and that can lead to complications. And they present to us in the last moment when the health is very bad, and they go to a point of no return where we can't bring back the patient to a healthy life. We just try our best, but then it's too late just because the patient came to us in the last moment.
Okay. The next question. How is the quality of the foreign medical graduates compared to the Indian medical graduates? Like you can say or in your words, like you'll be seeing, no, the people from there.
Yeah, medicine is the same everywhere. In any
Okay.
part of the world you study the same subjects, you study the same medicines, you study the same protocol or guidelines. So it doesn't differ much. It's about how each and individual doctor imbibes the knowledge, gets the knowledge, and puts into practice. So just that varies. It's upon individual doctors, but the education is good everywhere. Wherever you
Okay.
go, it's the same, and a doctor should know how to practice that and keep that into his practice. So that matters.
Basically, why I put this question is because the pass percentage shows a very, like, it's a very meager number of people. Like, they have to pass the MCA exam, as you know, Medical Council of India's exam. So why is the pass percentage very low among those people, like those who graduated from Russia, Philippines, and China,
Yeah,
and
for
all?
example, if you take US or Russia for example, TB is not that prevalent over there. They study about TB, but they don't see actual TB cases for them to practice or for them to get used to.
Okay.
So in India, TB is still very much in high numbers,
Prevalent,
and we
okay.
commonly see these TB cases in India. It's just an example I'm giving you. TB cases, malaria, and any tropical infections, dengue. So all these cases are much more common in India rather than in US or Russia, because India being a tropical country, so that is the reason why. So it's just about what cases you commonly see, you'll get used to it, you'll have the confidence of treating it better. So it's just about getting used to the cases over here. And that is why MCA has also made mandatory 1 year of internship for all foreign medical graduates. Whoever study outside should do 1 year of training in India, and with that period they get used to the cases over here, and they are equivalent. They are good enough.
So this internship is after they pass the exam, like after they
No,
pass the exam.
that is they have to pass the exam, and then they have this 1 year of training to be
Okay.
they have to undergo that before they get the license to practice in India.
Yeah, there is this article which I came across, which is saying that these FMGs are brought to India to join the COVID workforce. They are asking for exemption from the one-time exemption for the MCA exam. Are they really now in India, or did the government allow them to practice in India for the present situation of shortage of doctors or something?
Regarding that, I don't have any idea about it. It is more of a political issue which I don't want to comment on.
Yeah, okay. Is there any exit exam for Indian medical graduates after completion of MBBS?
Yeah, the medical education is changing every now and then. The National Medical Commission, that is the NMC, has proposed some sort of exit exam for all final year MBBS students. After that,
Okay.
which they pass that exam, it will be a common exam for giving entry into the post graduation and also
Okay.
for passing MBBS. So it's like a common exit exam has and an income entrance exam. So it's
For
still in
the
proposal
PG.
stage, not yet implemented. Yeah, for the PG. So NEET PG will be replaced by NEXT. That is National Entrance Exit Exam.
So it's now called as next presently.
No, it will be called as NEXT. As
Will
of
be
now,
called.
NEET PG is there. In the future, it
Okay.
will be called as NEXT.
Like the main issue, like last week there was this doctor's assault which happened in Assam. So it was like I don't know, it's very horrifying I can say, because he was
Yeah,
like assaulted very
my
badly.
comments are as in like that's what Indian people need to change their mindset. If they don't believe us, if they don't believe in allopathy or any doctor, for example, they should go to the doctor they believe in and they should get the treatment and trust the doctor that the doctor is giving the best treatment and also believe that he's not a god, he cannot do miracles. And he'll try his best to save his patient's life. He won't deliberately injure or harm a patient which he wants to save. And as you can see, more than 1,000 doctors have died combining the first wave and second wave. So if the doctors can save themselves, that there won't be even one death of a doctor. So people should understand that even doctors are dying due to COVID, and we don't have any direct treatment for COVID. It's all supportive and symptomatic treatment. We are treating the
Okay.
complications. It's a viral infection. We don't have antibiotics against a viral infection. We just need the body to fight optimally and not very aggressively and not very it needs to have optimal control over it. So we help the body to fight against it. We don't have any medicines directly acting on COVID yet. So people should
Okay.
understand that the virus is same for everyone. It doesn't discriminate that it's affecting a doctor or it's affecting a normal patient. So we doctors are trying our best, and in spite of that, if certain things like these happen, it really demotivates us and makes us question whether working in an environment like this, which is already such a stressful environment, which is already such a burdened, overburdened infrastructure because of this COVID. We are so much overburdened and we are sacrificing our life. We are risking our life working in COVID wards. If we want, we can very well be at home with our family and we may not agree to work in COVID wards. But since as a doctor, we do take up even in spite of risking our lives. And no amount of money is worth in giving up the life. And I'm very happy if anyone else can take my place because I'll exchange it in a minute because I don't want to risk my family. If something happens to me, that there's no one's gonna look after them, right? So we are risking our lives, and still, if we get this kind of feedback from the public, it is very disheartening and very demotivating to take any risk for any sick patient for that matter.
Okay. So generally, the do pay like what is the patient behavior like during in the times of emergency? They already panic, no?
There are
Like I
few
mean, the attender
that
in the patient.
you know that, right? There are 5 stages of grief, so that is there. So we try to explain at first itself to the patient attenders that they have brought the patient in a sick condition, and but they are just in denial. They don't agree to it, and they think that we can miraculously something will happen and that patient will get saved. But in spite of regularly telling them and sensitizing them, even then after we declare the news, it's like we are the first point of contact. We are the first ones in front of them to take their anger out. So I don't even blame the patient attenders for it, but they should understand that they should not vent their anger and their emotion on the doctors, which are trying their best to save the life of the patient. And sometimes we cannot help it. No amount of medicines and no amount of any doctor for that matter in the world can help them if the patient crosses a particular point. And if that happens, they should agree and they should know that the doctor did his best. In spite of knowing that the patient attenders do something like this, then we have no words and we don't know what to do next.
So actually, I've learned in a, like in the news, like after this Kolkata incident which happened in 2019, Like our doctor was hurled with a brick stone and he was fractured in his skull. So after that, they asked the government to have some laws for them, like a means of protection laws, like a set of laws, like they should confiscate the weapons before the patient enters the hospital, and a security person. So like, what is your opinion on this? Is it really necessary? Because you people do so much for our protection. So is there someone should be there to protect you also at
There
the
are
same system?
we for the general public, if something happens to them, they run to us. Whatever regarding the health issue, they run to us. If something happens to us, whom should we go and whom should we seek help from? If something is happening for us, I noticed many of my non-medicos, nobody bothered to even raise this issue after the Assam incident. I shared it on my status, I shared it on my Facebook, Instagram, everywhere. But not even one non-medical friend was ready to like, yes, this what is happening is wrong. And it should be like made viral, and the government should be made aware that this some stricter laws need to be in place. But nothing sort of this happened, and I feel, really felt bad that this kind of mindset will not take our public anywhere, and this will only create a distance for the doctor-patient relationship. A doctor will always then try to be on a safer side and take less risks, and he will always try to maintain a distance from his patient. Which is really bad for the patient in the long run, which is very bad for the Indian general public. So my opinion is on that is like they should understand and they should trust the doctor. If they don't trust the doctor, they shouldn't come to us in the first place.
So I guess the laws should be like definitely being heard by the government, like some sort of.
More than, see, there are laws in place, but nobody cares about them. If there's any law, you know about the judicial system, it takes a long time for any thing to be processed. So we have loopholes in the system. So nobody takes the laws seriously. It's just that there should be an awareness created that doctors are not deliberately trying to hurt you people, and they're trying their best, and they should understand that it's not always possible to save a patient. That's what I'm repeating it again, that we're not gods or we can't do any miracles. We can only try our best, and in spite of our best efforts, if anything untoward happens, they should agree with it, and they can grieve, but they shouldn't show their emotion in front of the doctors, which are actually trying to help them.
Okay, yeah. So, like, what is the present lockdown? Is it having any effect? Like, are you is that the patient load decreasing, and what is the difference you're seeing like
The
after this
patient load
lockdown?
is decreasing, but the ICUs are still full. I'm still working in a COVID ICU. So it's the sick cases are keeping on coming. So ICUs are still full. It's going on, but the mild cases have decreased. The positivity rate has decreased. For example, if you test 100 people, only 10 to 10, 5 to 10 people are positive right now. So that has come down. So that has made some effect. Lockdown has made a significant change in the positivity rate of COVID. I should say that. I just want to tell one thing that the thing is like the hospitals have only certain number of beds and certain number of infrastructure. Only if you stop the cases from coming, they can function efficiently. We can't have beds like we have a population of 1.25 billion. And if 1 billion get affected out of 1.25, we can't have beds for 1 billion patients. It's really not possible in any country for that matter. So the only way is to stop the transmission, let the people who are sick at least get treated, and at least stop the chain of transmission. For example, it's a very good example that you have to make the roads better to stop the road traffic accidents so that we prevent the accidents from happening rather than just treating the road traffic accident. So that's important.
So the present lockdown has definitely had some
Yeah,
sort of effect
definitely.
now on the.
Definitely.
Yeah, are there any like this white fungus and yellow fungus cases in Chennai presently? Because the first was a black fungus, Then the other type of funguses were reported in north in Ghaziabad. So did you see
It
any
has
cases here?
actually no significant term as a white fungus or a black fungus. It's just a common term used for the common public to understand better. The thing
Okay.
is, it's a fungal infection. What the public has to know that it's a fungal infection, which is mostly seen in patients. We have seen most in patients, so like after they have got COVID or during that COVID infection, because their immune system is really going through a lot of stress. And if they are a diabetic, they are having more chances of getting this fungal infection because the immune system takes a toll. Because in diabetes or in people with having diabetes, the immune system is functions a bit less. It doesn't function to its maximum capacity. Plus, COVID also changes the immune system in a variety of ways which we are yet to know, which causes an increased incidence of these fungal infections. They most commonly occur in people who are immunocompromised. For example, in any people who are taking, who are sick or who are already on any immunosuppressant drugs or who are immunodeficient for some matter. So normal public, general public shouldn't fear for this. They should just be aware that they should watch out for signs and symptoms. I've even made a video on that, that the general public who are healthy need not be worried. Only the people who have been affected with COVID or people like who have diabetes, or the immune system is not functioning for some particular reason. So they should be worried and they should watch out for the symptoms. There's no need to panic for the general public.
So, about this exam preparation normally for those who are planning to come into the medical field, like as you said, what is the pass probability of the NEET exam, like
There's nothing called
presently?
pass probability or anything. Obviously, you need a minimum 50%
50%.
to qualify. There's nothing called a pass thing. It's a qualification that you need at least 50% of marks to qualify for the exam. And then the seats are given on a rank basis. The rank one chooses the topmost college and it goes on from there.
So the 50% is from the 12th cutoff or the result from the NEET?
From the NEET.
NEET.
Yeah.
So I think we are done with this.
And I really thank you, Shiva, for bringing out this matter. You're one of my non-medicos that really understood about this matter, and I really liked the video, whatever was that before it, which you told about the doctors getting attacked. We need people like
Thank you.
you, producing such videos and making such videos and making people aware that we are also humans. Please treat us as humans and please don't treat us as gods. We are not gods. Please treat us as a human being. And we'll always try to save our patients' life and we always see the best out of all our patients and we always want to send them home happy. So that is very important for us.
Thank you, doctor. Thank you for accepting my invitation. Actually, I know you're being very busy in the ICU, so I didn't want to disturb you, but still I wanted this live to be the need of the hour, so many people
Yes,
can.
my pleasure. And I hope the general public understands the situation the doctors are facing right now, the stress they are under, and the problems we are under, and the risk we are posing for our family if we go back to our homes. And that is why, I mean, right now I'm staying in a hotel because I can't go back to my home.
Yeah, of
So the
course.
thing is, we are facing a lot of stress from all quarters of life. And we don't want an added stress that our patient and our patient attenders itself give this emotional stress to us. It's really not needed and we really don't deserve it. And I just hope they understand that even we have our own limitations. And I hope this video just spreads the awareness that they need to know regarding us.
Just one simple question, like I just made it now. Like, what was your mindset like after this coronavirus? Like, the stress levels have increased, or generally life in a doctor, like life of a doctor is generally like
Yeah,
stressful.
generally
Like,
the
what
life
was
of a doctor
pre-COVID and
is,
post-COVID like? You can say it.
pre-COVID it was like other diseases took the upper hand. Like even pre-COVID era, there were many diseases that we needed: dengue, chikungunya, malaria, and all other forms of cancers, and road traffic accidents, everything was there. So we doctors generally, even if we do have a social life, it's very limited. Personal life is more limited than the social life. And we have to like actually make time for our personal and social life. We don't just really get it. We have to make time for it and allot particular time for it because our schedules are so hectic. We have 12 to 48 hours, for 24 to 48 hours of shifts. Like in government hospitals, you can work for 36 hours at a stretch. And that really takes a toll on your health too, on a doctor's health. So working for 36 hours continuously, it's not easy. So the stress levels always, this is the being a doctor is actually very stressful. But if you're passionate about it, and if you really want to heal your patients and treat your patients, you will develop a way to balance your life. But yeah, the stress factor will always be there. But you have to take, be happy with whatever reward you get by making the patients good, by sending them home happily. And that is what we want. And a smile on the patient's face is really means a lot for us. And post-COVID, the stress is obviously we are not able to see our families. We are not able to like be like for the past 2 years, I don't think I have been much with my family. Like out of like 750 days, half of the time I was in my COVID duties and non-COVID duties and all that. So it's really stressful. And now because of such incidents, it's really making us question that is it all worth it, sacrificing so much our health, our personal life, our family and our family's well-being just to come back to sleep or come back to the hotel and look at all these videos of the ungrateful public. So it really makes us question, but still the most important thing is I still want to make sure that my patients get healed, they get treated, and I do the best for my patients always. Whenever I take up a case, I make sure that I can do the best for them, whatever I can. And we'll always have that mindset. Whatever you say, we'll always have that mindset and we'll always want to do the best for our patients. But still deep down, we just hope that the public realizes and appreciates us for our work and also understand that not all, everything is possible by a doctor's hand, and they should accept they should accept whatever a doctor has done. He's done his best, and wouldn't harm a patient in any knowing or unknowingly way. So that's important.
Yeah, that's it, doctor. Thank you, and
thank you, Shiva.
Pleasure having interview with you.
Take care.
Yeah.
And hope the public all follows all proper precautions and prevents a third wave from emerging. If the third wave comes, we are already stressed and we'll not. I don't think we are really tired actually after these 2 years. And I hope the public realizes that. And for their own good, they should take seriously and don't repeat the mistakes what happened last time, which led to the upsurgence of the second wave. I hope.
Yeah, doctor. Thank you. And we'll see you
thank
next
time. Take care. Bye-bye.
Yeah, that was Dr. Ronak Jain for you. And you can watch this video on my YouTube channel, Shiv Krish Vlogs. The total live session will be posted on my YouTube session. And kindly support me and watch this video if you have any doubts about the COVID problem and also the general question relating to the medical field. And kindly post in the comments what more sessions do I need to do and what all live sessions are you interested, so that I will get an idea about what's the present situation. And thank you once again for joining this live, and good night everyone. Thank you.